Okay, my name is Ryan Grimm. Today I will talk about smart pointers. My talk is part of the Back to Basics track, and I will explain to you in maybe 1 hour the basics to smart pointers. Okay, I should add a few words about me, only a few words. I'm trainer for C++ in Python since 2024. I don't know it so exactly. Since 2016, I'm an independent trainer for mainly C++, but also Python. Okay, let's start. This is the overview of my talk. So, of course, it sounds strange. In my overview, I give an overview. Okay, I talk about the classical three smart pointers we have in C++ 11, unique pointer, shared pointer, and weak pointer. Then afterwards, I talk about special aspects of smart pointers, such as performance, such as concurrency. In particular, shared pointer is extremely comfortable when used in concurrent environments. And at the end, I talk about a very interesting topic. How should you pass a smart pointer or how should you pass an argument to a function? And how should a function return its value? And this story is in particular interesting regarding smart pointers. Okay, without further ado, let's start. A first overview. Okay, we have smart pointers in C++, essentially since C++ 11. They are called smart because they are pointers, but they also have a kind of smartness. And this smartness is that they take care of the underlying resource. According to the Ray idiom, Ray stands for resource acquisition initialization. This means, essentially, they release the resource when the smart pointers goes out of scope, it releases the resource, the underlying resource. From one perspective, you can understand them as a kind of garbage collection in C++. And we have them in four versions, but only three of them you should use. Okay, I mentioned this word Ray, and Ray is so an important idiom in C++ that I should explain it to you. Have a look. Sorry, wrong button. Ray. Wrong. The resolution is too big, so I cannot see it. Here's my Ray example. Here's Ray. What does Ray stands for? Resource acquisition is initialization. What does it mean? It means essentially you acquire a resource in the constructor of an class and you release it in the destructor of a class. And the key idea is to understand that this class or this instance of this class, such as this instance of resource guard, is a local object. And the C++ compiler takes care of locals. This is the key idea. So you put something which will live forever, such as memory, when you don't release it, into a local object, and the compiler takes care of local objects because they are bound to a local scope. You can use this idiom for smart pointers, of course. This is the reason why I talk about here. But you can also use it for mutexes, or you can use it for file objects, for sockets, and in C++ they are used heavily. So this Ray idiom is used heavily, and the most prominent example is the containers of the standard template library, such as studvector or also studstring. Why? A studvector, for example, is a local object which takes care of its underlying elements, which are allocated on the heap. And when the local object goes out of scope, also the heap allocated objects are destroyed. Okay, now let me show it to you live. I have here a resource guard. this is not Ray, but this is, should only help you to exemplify Ray. You see, in the constructor, I say acquire. In the destructor, I say release. And then I'll release this stuff. Now let me execute the program and let's see what's happening. Let's start here. I create a local object, resguard1, which takes care of memory block 1. And have a look. This resguard1 goes out of scope exactly here at the end of main. Therefore, it's called, we will find here, release the memory block 1. Exactly at the end, you see, release the memory block 1. It goes on. Here I created a local resguard. You see, this ends the lifetime of resguard 2. This means exactly here, resguard 2 is created, and exactly here, this is deterministic destruction behavior, exactly here, resguard 2 goes out of scope, and consequently, we see this messages. Before local scope, acquire release after local scope. You see, exactly there. And now to something more interesting. What would happen if an exception occur? Have a look. Before try catch block, then I create here a local object, resguard 3, and here, exactly here, I throw an exception. And anyway, exactly in this line 36, the destructor of resguard 3 is called. And you see, can observe it here. Before try catch block, acquire, release, then stood beta log, this is this message here, and afterwards, after try catch block. Okay, once more, this is the way, for example, smart pointers work. Okay. Oh, sorry, this was the wrong direction. Pause. Let me go to the beginning. Overview, here we are. We have four different smart pointers in C++, say 17, or I should say 14. Anyway, you will see it in a few seconds. Okay, we have auto putter, unique pointer. I explicitly wrote stop here, to which I will come in a few seconds. And we have shared putter, weak putter. They model two kinds of ownership, exclusive ownership and shared ownership. So AutoPutter and UniquePutter are exclusive owner, means they take care of exactly one resource. And AutoPutter is stuff we already have since C++ 98. But AutoPutter had a big, big design issue. And this design issue was, you could copy it. And this is strange, once more. This is an exclusive owner and you couldn't copy it. What under the hood essentially happened was, instead of a copy, a move operation was performed. And this was a cause for many, many errors. And for that reason, with 11, we got UniquePutter and you should replace AutoPutter with UniquePutter. Consequently, AutoPutter was deprecated in 11 and removed in 17. In particular, C++ 17. Okay, they model exclusive ownership and they model shared ownership. When you copy a shared pointer, in short, shared putter, when you copy a shared putter, a reference counter will be increased by one. When you delete it, it will be decreased by one. When the reference counter becomes zero, the underlying resource would be destroyed. Okay. Shared putter have a classical issue, and this is when you have a cycle of shared putter. Then the reference counter will never become zero, which means they will never be deleted, which means you have a memory leak. And to break such a cycle, you should use a weak pointer and put it in between. And this is exactly the job of a weak putter, to break cycles of shared putter. Okay, this was the overview. Now I talk about each of these three guys in more detail. Okay. Unique putter, exclusive ownership. Managed lifetime of its resource, fine, we know it. You should use it instead of an auto putter, of course, we know it. Your unique putter cannot be copied. You can only move it. This is the essential difference to an auto putter. So you have to move it. You can even use a unique putter inside a container of the standard template library, such as .vector. But you cannot copy it inside because it cannot be copied. You have to move it inside. For example, you have to say vector.pushback stud move unique putter. Okay. You can even apply an algorithm of the standard template library to this unique vector of unique pointers. And the issue, the key observation is now that the algorithm of the standard template library use internally move semantic, so you can modify in vector of unique putters. If they would use copy semantic, this would not be possible. And here's a very interesting observation. A unique putter is per design as cheap in space and time such as a raw putter. And this is the reason for this following sentence. Don't use raw putter anymore on the user level. On the implementation level, maybe you have to use it to implement something, but as someone writing application and using functions and classes and objects, there's no reason to use a raw putter. Just use a unique pointer. You can even parameterize a unique pointer with a special deleter. For example, when you have a unique putter which takes care of an int, the destructor of int is called in case. But maybe you want to have a unique pointer which takes care of a file, so you cannot delete a file. What you can do, you implement a special deleter which will close the file. And additionally, there's a specialization for arrays available. Okay, this is the interface of a unique pointer. And afterwards, I show you a small example, but because unique pointers are quite easy to get. Okay, with release, it returns the underlying resource. And afterwards, you have an empty unique pointer and you have to take explicitly care of the underlying resource. This is the release call. Okay. With get, you get a pointer to the underlying resource. Maybe you have a C function which can only, which needs a pointer. So with unique.get, you get back a pointer to this underlying resource and therefore you can invoke the unique point, the C function. Reset is special. With reset, you can say unique pointer take care of some new resource. What would now happen is that the old resource is deleted and unique pointer takes care of a new resource. You can even invoke it without an argument. In this case, only the destructor of the underlying resource is called. With getDeleter, I mentioned to you, you can parameterize the unique pointer with a special deleter, and here's the way to get this special deleter. Maybe you want to have a special deleter which builds state. I will show you an example, but in this case it's a shared pointer, which is similar in this regard. And makeUnique is a function we have since C++ 14. And this is a function for creating a unique pointer, which takes care of an underlying resource. And this is, by the way, the preferred way to create a unique pointer. Okay, now let me show you an example. So far, no question. Okay, I will close this one. here unique pointer, to easily observe the behavior of my resources, my resource, my int. I just wrote a small wrapper around the int, you see, constructor, destructor. When this object goes out of scope, you see, it calls goodbye, it says goodbye. And here is the main program. First, let me execute it. Here we are. And now let me show you the site. Here I create a unique pointer which takes care of my int. And this my int is dynamically allocated. Additional remark here, I used here the unique explicit unique pointer call because this is a program which is based on C++ 11. Make unique is only available since C++ 14. When I ask with get now for the underlying resource, it returns the address of the underlying resource. And here's the interesting part. When I move the unique pointer 1 to unique pointer 2, the underlying resource is moved, which means afterwards unique pointer 1 is an empty pointer, null putter. And now unique pointer 2 is the owner. It's the owner of the resource. When you, maybe you don't know when you want, when you should use std move. On the application level, such as here, you should use std move when you explicitly want to transfer ownership. You should not read this as std move, but as transfer ownership. And this is the right use case for move in this regard. You just transfer ownership. First, unique pointer 1 was the owner of this dynamically allocated 1998. Afterwards, unique pointer 2. Okay. Have a look. Here I have locket putter. And you see it goes exactly here out of scope. And therefore, here we see goodbye from 23. And here's a little bit more, this is a little bit more complicated, but this is, it could not become more complicated. I say reset it to 2011. This means the destructor of unique pointer 2 is called, you see, goodbye from 1998. Then I release the content or the resource of unique pointer 2. I take it with my int, and now I'm the owner. Therefore, I have to explicitly call delete. With unique pointer, in general, you cannot make any error. There's only one error you could make. And this is an anti-pattern. Don't do that. Have a look. I will do it only to show it to you. I call it my int 15 equal you my int 15. I create my resource outside of the curly braces. And now I say, okay, unique pointer 1 should take care of my int 15. So far, so good. But now comes the issue. When I duplicate this unique pointer 1 call, maybe 15, now I have an issue. What's the issue? The issue is that I have two owners of my int 15. And this means, in particular, I two times delete would be called. And this is undefined behavior. I don't know what would happen on my platform. In general, you can expect a segmentation fault. But once more, it's undefined behavior. Let me try it out only once. If we see something strange here with this program, unique pointer. Yeah, you see, it didn't crash, but you see goodbye from 0. This is a sign that something strange happened because I never used the number 0 in my code here before. So in this case, we got no segmentation fault, but a strange value, which is a sign for a hint for undefined behavior. Okay, this was the unique pointer one. So far, any question? No. Therefore, I continue. I should mention, if you have questions, ask them in the ask them, and I will read them in the private chat, and I try to answer them. And afterwards, I will also be in the Remo room, and you can ask me questions. Okay, now talk about more interesting stuff. Shared putter. Once more, when you copy a shared putter, the reference counter increases from 1 to 2, and both shared pointer share the same resource. This is, once more, shared ownership. Okay, what's the job of a shared pointer? Each shared pointer has a reference to the resource, okay, and the reference counter. It's a kind of garbage collection. Why do I say that? For example, in Python, garbage collection is based on this kind of pointers, on shared pointers. Now is a strange here's a strange sentence, has more or less overhead in time and space, such as a raw pointer. When you have a shared pointer with a reference count of one, of course, it's more expensive than a unique pointer or raw pointer. But when you have a reference counter bigger than one, it may be cheaper because you only have to create the resource once. It deletes the resource, of course. You can also implement it or instantiate it with a special deleter. This is a special deleter, which would be used to delete int. And here's also a little bit a strange, maybe strange sounding sentence. The question is a shared pointer thread safe? And the answer is, it depends. The control block of a shared pointer and thread safe. This means the reference counter goes atomically up and atomically down. And the resource is deleted exactly once. But what is not exception safe is the underlying resource. Once more, the control block is thread safe, but not the underlying resource. So it's kind of thread safe. Here's the interface of a shared pointer. You can check if this shared pointer is the only, the only owner. You can ask for the reference counter. With get, you get the underlying pointer. With reset, you can reset the shared pointer. This is a little bit more tricky. You can see my hands. Oh, sorry. So here we are. Assume this is the shared resource, and I have one shared pointer and a second shared pointer. When I say to the right one, take care of something other, so reset to something other, this shared pointer goes down, the counter goes down from 2 to 1, and this one starts with 1. This means when the reference counter before was 1 and you say reset to something else, the old resource is destructed. You can even invoke reset without an argument. In this case, only this shared pointer stops its ownership. So it depends how you invoke it and what's the number of the reference counter. With get deleter, such as before, you get back the deleter. And here's something interesting, which you should use, of course. Make shared is a factory function to create a shared pointer. And make shared is way faster than invoking std shared putter, for example, int explicitly. Okay, let me show you why. When you look here, when you create a shared pointer, or let me show it to you with an example, which makes it maybe more obvious. When you have a look here, when you create a shared pointer, two memory allocations are involved. First of all, you allocate new myint 1998, and second, you allocate memory for the control block. Two memory allocations. Memory allocations are quite expensive. Therefore, when you invoke make shared, this two memory allocation becomes one. And therefore, instead of two memory allocation, you get one, which is a little bit bigger and, of course, way faster. So I will show you a few performance numbers in a few minutes. But so far, I want to say make shared is way faster than, say, std shared pointer, which I did here. Okay. Is there anything else I want to say? No. This is exactly the example I want to show you. This is the, how should I say it? The basic example to a shared pointer. I have a constructor which says hello, displays the value, and destructor which says goodbye, and also displays the value. And here, let me execute it. Share, the D is missing. Here we are. Have a look. You see, hello 1998. The use count is 1. When I copy the shared pointer, the use count becomes 2, because now I have 2 owners. Here, local shared pointer is a local object, so this, it goes out of scope here. Therefore, here the use count is 1. When I make a copy assignment, the use counter becomes 2 once more. You see it here, 2. And when I say reset global shared pointer here, the use count becomes 1. And now I want to show you something more interesting. When I now say shared pointer should take care of a different resource, first the constructor of 2011 is called, then the constructor of shared putter, because the reference counter was 1. And at the end, exactly here, have a look, exactly here, the destructor of shared pointer is called, and this is the reason why we see here, goodbye, 2011. Okay, I think it's a good time to make a short break and answer a few questions. But first, let me read them. Questions. Are there any cases where using a raw pointer would be preferred over a smart pointer? Yes, but you have to wait for a few minutes. If there's no guarantee that a destructor will be called, how can anyone rely on Ray? Maybe you misunderstood me or I explained it in the wrong way. The destructor is called because it's a local object. It's a job of the compiler of the C++ runtime to call the destructor of a local when it goes out of scope. This is a stack variable. Would using the unique get mean that we get hold of the underlying pointer and then use that elsewhere? I have to read it once more. Would using the unique pointer get mean that we get hold of the underlying pointer and then use that elsewhere? But the unique pointer has gone out of scope at that time. Exactly. In this case, you have to be careful. But this is a different story, to which I will come later. Pointer means in C++, modern C++, you just borrow something. You are never the owner. And when you borrow something, you don't know because you're not an owner. Do you think Ray is a fitting name? Shouldn't be more like resource destruction? You're totally right. But anyway, this acronym was, as far as I know, created by Bjarne himself. And it's now burnt into our minds. So we are just used to it. But you can also create an acronym which calls more about the destruction behavior, which is the essential part of Ray. But anyway, you're right. Okay, let's continue. Honestly, what I showed you so far was the basic stuff. Now I want to go to the more advanced use cases, which is fine. It took me about half an hour. This is an extremely simple example, but for a long example, I need more time. Once more, this is my int, which is a small wrapper around the int. I say goodbye in the destructor, and sorry, I showed you the wrong example, but anyway, this looks similar. What I want to show you once more, what I want to show you is how can I use a special deleter? How can we achieve that? And this is my special deleter. You see, the call operator is overloaded. It takes a pointer, which is the type a deleter takes. And then it is a deleter, therefore it deletes. So far, nothing interesting. But here's the interesting part. I have a static variable count, and my deleter just counts how often it was invoked. And I use a function to display this information. With this type ID name stuff here, I get a string representation of the type of my deleter. So for an int, t, when t is an int, I would get an e with GCC-Klang with a Microsoft int. And then I count how much memory I've freed so far. So how often I was called times size of t. And these two lines are only a way to display this information in a human readable way. Okay, and here see, this is my count, my static. And here I define or initialize my count. And here I create an alias for it for int, because I only use it for int in this case. And now let me show you something. I execute this stuff. And now let me show you something. Here I create a short pointer using my deleter. You see, my deleter. And this also here. And now I want to ask, give me my deleter. And I want to ask, how many objects I deleted so far and how many bytes I freed so far. And you see it, I deleted ints, I'm a deleter for ints, we know it, and I deleted 0 bytes because nothing happened so far. But when I say reset, shared pointer 2 is now no owner, shared pointer 2 stopped his ownership. And therefore, get info displays, it's a deleter for int, of course you know it, but I freed 4 bytes because the int has 4 bytes. And now some stuff, it's only a little bit of randomness. What I do here, I create a random number between 1 and 1,000. And create exactly this number of shared pointer. And each shared pointer goes out of scope exactly here. You see, it's a local. And I want to know how many shared pointer I created. And after I invoke this function, I use this temporary object to get the info with the call getInfo. And getInfo says to me 4060 bytes are freed, so you can divide it by 4 and you know that I created 390 shared pointers so far, if I didn't make an error. Okay, this was special. And you see, this can be done with a special deleter. You can put some logic inside. Okay, let me continue with the questions. The common case I see for using your pointer is an observer in case you are... I don't get this question. I will come to this question some way in a few minutes, so let me skip it here. I will go to the second question. Why does the shared pointer come with a thread set count if set is not needed for every application? Does this come with any performance cost? Good observation. A shared pointer is not for free. You have to increase the counter and decrease it. Both are atomic operations, but they cost a little bit. it's not so expensive. So this would not, for me, a reason to use it or not to use it. In case of a unique pointer, you can just use it. Don't think, just use it. It's for free. This is a SharePoint that costs a little bit, and you have to think sometimes a little bit, to which I will come in a few minutes. And now let me ask the last question. Does it make sense to pass a SharePoint to function by value? This is exactly a point I will mention in a few minutes. So let me skip this question for now. Okay, I see you are totally interested in my additional stuff. Okay, std weak pointer is not a classically smart pointer. Now I come to std weak pointer. std weak pointer is not a smart pointer. It's called a smart pointer, but it's not smart. Why? It does not allow you accessing the underlying resource. It just borrows the resource from a shared pointer. It's not an owner. You cannot access the resource, what I said. But, and this is very interesting, you can make out of a weak pointer, or weak pointer could generate a shared pointer. And this means for a short period of time, it may be, you may have an owner, to be more specific, in shared owner. But once more, the reason for having weak pointer is we want to get rid of cyclic references, because a cyclic reference of shared pointer means memory leak. Okay. This is the interface of a weak pointer. You see, it's really weak. You can only ask if it's expired. This means you don't know what's happening with the underlying resource because you are not an owner. So you can ask, is there still a resource available? With use count, you get the reference counter. And this is a strange method, a member function, log. It counts, is, for me, it has an extremely bad name, but anyway, log is a function when the weak pointer has an underlying resource or borrowed, shared pointer gave him an underlying resource. Then this log call would be successful, what means that this weak log call would return a shared pointer, and therefore this log call would produce a new shared owner. I will show you an example in a few seconds. And with reset, as before, the weak pointer can release its resource. First, let me show you an easy example. Weak pointer, here we are. Let me delete the stuff I don't need anymore. Cancel. Sorry, I should. Don't save. Here we are. This is the weak pointer. You see, weak pointer. Let me execute this program. And here I use the function makeShared, which is the way you should create a shared pointer. And you can use a shared pointer to initialize a weak pointer. But the key observation is the use count is only one. So a weak pointer does not increase the reference count. This is key. And when you ask weak pointer, when you ask the weak pointer if it's expired, it says no or false. And here's the interesting call. Because weak pointer is not expired, this call would be successful and it returns a shared pointer. And here I have created a shared pointer out of the weak pointer. And this shared pointer will live exactly until line 17. And when I would ask how for the value of the reference counter, you would see that here inside the reference counter is 2 because I have a new owner. Once more, look at this line after shared pointer 2011, and now you will see a 2. But first, I have to compile it once more. Weak putter. Oh, but you see 2. This means this is exactly you want to deal with a weak pointer. You use a weak pointer to break cycles of shared pointer. But if you want to use a weak pointer to go from one node to the other, which is not possible, you to make a shared pointer out of it, go to the next node, and then the shared pointer goes out of scope. And from that point on, you can deal with sizes of shared pointer. Okay, when I release the weak pointer, this call would not succeed, and therefore I get the call. I end in the branch don't get resource or in the else branch. Okay, let me answer one question. Is there a way to get non-owning pointers to object owned by a unique pointer while disallowing the ability to delete it? Once more, this is a question I would delay to later because I will answer this question in my last two or three slides. Okay, now to some bad story. No, not so far. So far, let me show something. When you ask yourself, how can you produce a cycle of shared pointer? I always thought, no, it's not easy, but you can do it. For example, this is a doubly linked list. When you use in this direction a shared pointer, and in this direction a shared pointer, of course you would have a cycle. What you typically will do, you use in this direction a shared pointer, and in this direction a weak pointer. And when you want to go from this node to this node using the smart pointer, you make out of the weak pointer and shared pointer. This is the way you would handle it. And now to my sad story. I want to show you a cycle. Let's see. I have a small family, a mother, daughter, and a son. The mother has a weak pointer to the daughter and a shared pointer to the son. The daughter has a shared pointer to the mother. The son has a shared pointer to the mother. And now the key observation. Where is the cycle of shared pointers? Exactly here. And now I make this picture runnable or make code out of it. And you will see, we will only see the destructor of daughter when this family goes out of scope. Let's have a look. Here's the example in code. I have mother. Each member says when it's the destructor is called. Mother gone, son gone, daughter gone. You see? I have the mother. The mother creates here the shared pointer to son. And here the weak pointer to the daughter. You see? It takes the daughter by a weak pointer. Here's the son. It gets in the constructor the shared pointer to mother, the same for the daughter. And this is exactly in code the picture I showed you before. And now let's see what's happening. I created the mother, the son, and the daughter. Then I connected them. Now the mother has a shared pointer to the son and a weak pointer to the daughter, when I remember it right. And this is exactly this picture here, encoded in C++. And here something terrible happens, a big accident. And this means all of them die, because they go out of scope here. But when I execute a program, you will see that only daughter says daughter gone. Why? Because daughter is not in a cycle of shared pointers involved. Should be the name of the program. You see, only daughter gone. We have a memory leak regarding mother and son because they are in a cycle. Okay. Now to the, okay. No new questions, sorry. For this mumbling. Okay, now to a more few very interesting observations. First of all, performance. I said to you, just use a unique pointer. They are as fast and as memory cheap as a raw pointer. And here a few numbers. I created I think 100 million. I created 100 million ints and I deleted them. I did the same for unique pointer, for make unique, shared putter, and make shared. I measured the time here and measured the time here. I did this performance test with Microsoft and Linux. These are Linux numbers with different PCs. I did this performance test with maximum optimization, meaning -03 or -0x on Windows. And these are the numbers. You see, new std unique pointer and std make unique are in the same ballpark. Shared putter is way slower. But when you use make shared, it's not so bad anymore. It's about 50% slower. And the reason is that make shared only makes one memory allocation. And here you have two. First one, second one here inside. And here, one allocation exactly here. Once more, there's no reason to use for performance reasons a raw pointer. Just use a unique pointer. And you see that make unique is a little bit faster than new and std unique pointer. I don't know why. But make unique is always a little bit faster than unique pointer and even make a raw pointer call. They made internally some tricks. I could observe it with GCC, Clang, and Microsoft, but I didn't invest more time to find a reason. Okay, this was performance. Here is only when you have my slides, you can use it and read more details to it. And now about concurrency. And then we come up to function arguments and return values. Concurrency. As I mentioned it before, a shared pointer is kind of thread safe. The control block is thread safe, but not the resource. And there's an extremely nice pattern. When you have something shared and you don't know who is the last owner, because you share it between threads, just put it in a shared pointer and the problem is solved by using the right technique. Have a look here. I have my int. Let me start here. I have a thread creator, okay. The thread creator creates two threads, thread T1, thread T2. And the key observation is that both threads use the same shared pointer here, you see? They perform the function show number and use shared pointer. And the interesting part is you don't know which thread lives longer. So you don't know when you should call delete, when you would use a raw pointer. But with a shared pointer, this is quite easy. Why? Because the last one, which decrements the reference counter from from 1 to 0, will automatically delete the resource. So you see, it's fine by definition. And here's show number. Show number is the function which both thread execute, which use this shared putter. And let me perform it, or let me execute it. You see, it takes 1 second because I said it should wait, sleep for 1 second. But anyway, you have a shared pointer, which is shared between two threads. You don't know which thread will live longer. So you would not know when to delete this stuff. Just put it in a shared pointer. When the first thread goes out of scope, it decrements the shared pointer by 1. When the second thread goes out of scope, it decrements the shared pointer also by 1. So it goes first from 2 to 1, then from 1 to 0, and then the shared pointer deletes the underlying resource. So this is quite a nice pattern to deal with shared ownership between threads. Use a shared pointer. But there's more to tell about shared pointers. There's a contradiction in modern C++. one rule you should have in mind is when you program concurrently is be as local as possible or don't share. But of course, shared pointer is shared by definition. And if you cannot remember it, remember this sentence by Tony von Erd. Forget what you learned in kindergarten, stop sharing. This is an extremely important rule in concurrency. Don't share. And now we have an issue. One perspective, we should use a shared pointer, and another, from another point of view, we should not share. And for that reason, std shared pointer is a special object. std shared pointer is the only data type in C++ 11 which supports, which you can use with atomic operations, such as load store and load store and stuff. And this was the C++ 11 solution, but it was a kind too error prone. Therefore, with C++ 20, once more, C++ 20, we got an atomic shared pointer, an atomic weak pointer. What does it mean? With atomic shared pointer, not only the control block is thread safe, but also the underlying resource. So you can share it between threads. Okay, here is a std atomic shared pointer, which is essentially a partial specialization of std atomic for shared pointer and the same for weak pointer. This is stuff we will get to C++ 20. Okay, and now I will answer many questions I had in the last 10 minutes when I talk about function arguments and return values. And this is for me the most important part of my talk. Okay. This is a kind of a protocol which I developed based on the C++ core guidelines, or to say differently, based on best practices with modern C++. Assume I have a function. The function takes the argument by value, could take the argument by value, by pointer, by reference, by unique pointer, and by shared pointer. What does it mean from the ownership semantic? Ownership semantic is the question, who should call delete? The caller or the callee? So the function or the guy who created this pointer? And now let me think about it. When a function takes in value an argument by value, by copy, it gets an independent owner. It's an independent owner of the resource. And the resource is exactly released when the function body of func ends, because it's the job of the stack. It's a local. This means you don't have to call delete because it's the job of the C++ runtime. In this case, fine, just copy it. Both values are independent, so the caller's value and the function's value are two different variables because it's a copy. And now to something which you should do, the mindset is the following one in modern C++. When a function takes an argument by pointer, it never means transfer of ownership. By pointer only means the function, the resource was borrowed. It was created outside and the function just get a handle to it. This means when you don't own something, you of course are not allowed to call delete because you're not an owner. Okay. With a pointer, you have each time you use this pointer inside the function, check if this pointer is a null pointer. Of course, this could be. But once more, the interesting observation is never call delete because you're not an owner. And this is, by the way, for me, a big issue with all C++. With all C++, or classic C++ or legacy C++, C++ before 11. You have a function which gets an owner, which gets a pointer, and you don't know if the function now, if the function borrowed this pointer, or if the function is the owner. You don't know. In any way, you would get a double delete if you delete something you should not delete, or you would get a memory leak if you forget to delete. So you can only make it wrong. But now it's crystal clear. You only borrow the stuff. And the difference to a reference is you just borrow it, but you have to guarantee that it could never be zero because the reference has always a value. So once more, point and reference are similar, but with the reference, you have to guarantee that the underlying resource has always a value, or put it the other way. You have to guarantee that there is a resource. What does std unique pointer mean? Unique pointer means the caller has transferred the ownership inside to the function. Now the function is the owner of the unique pointer. I want to make it more clear by providing you a little bit of code, because this is too less. Assume this is a function which takes a unique pointer by copy. Okay, this is only the function signature. When I have a unique pointer outside std make unique. So I have a unique pointer. No, this is some make unique wrong. Maybe initialize this 5. When I, as a caller, want to call this function func, I have to say func std move unique. Oh, sorry, I forgot the name. Here we are. You see, the caller has explicitly to say move, which means it moves the unique pointer inside the function. This is transfer of ownership. This means the function now is the owner of the unique pointer and, of course, of the underlying resource. And this means also the function is responsible for deleting the unique pointer and the underlying resource. Quite easy, huh? And what does shared pointer mean? Shared pointer means when this function is called, the reference counter is increased by 1 and function is a shared owner as the function is valid. When the function is executed, the function is a shared pointer, a shared owner of this shared pointer, because the reference count was increased by 1. This means the shared pointer could never be, the underlying resource could never be destroyed while function is using the shared pointer. So far, extremely fine, extremely easy. And once more, you don't have to call delete because the shared pointer takes care of the ownership of the resource by managing the reference count. Okay, I will add a few additional remarks because I had already questions regarding this table. Let me be a little bit more specific. When you take a unique pointer by reference, this gives this function the possibility to change the underlying resource here. So this is the reason for a unique pointer by reference. You want to change the underlying resource. When you have a shared pointer, when you copy it, fine, you are a shared owner. The reference count will increase by 1. The reference count will be decreased by 1 when the function ends. When you take the shared pointer by reference, this means func is not an owner. it's just borrowed. And this gives this function the possibility to reset the underlying int so that all shared owner afterwards have a different shared resource. And const share pointer, there's honestly, I don't have a use case for it. I would, in this case, just use a raw pointer or reference. Okay. Once more, this is an extremely important table. And this means I need 2-3 minutes and I'm ready with my talk. This means essentially, when you look at a function signature, you can explicitly see how is ownership handled. And this is extremely nice because only, you know, based on the types, or if you take it by pointer, by reference, by unipointer, share pointer, you explicitly specify who is responsible for what. And now my last slide before I'm done. When you have a factory method, such as create window, which should create a window, okay. In former times, you created this function create window, created a window on the heap, and this function returned a pointer to the underlying to the created window. And this was extremely terrible. Why? You have one interface pointer, and you transfer two types of ownerships, borrower and ownership. Because this window here outside has no idea if it just borrowed it from this create window factory or if it's the owner of the window. If this function outside is the owner, it has to call delete. If not, of course not. This was terrible. This pointer, one interface, but two semantics. But now we can do it extremely easily. Why? We don't return a pointer, we return a unique pointer or shared pointer. When a factory function such as here returns a unique pointer, it means it transferred the ownership to the outsider or to the caller. When it returns a shared pointer, it says it shares ownership. So the caller and the function itself is owner of this window, and the last owner will delete it. Okay, now I'm done with my talk. You see it here, and I want to answer a few questions. Let me read the first one. On a multi-thread application, how can I maintain the control of the reference count in case I don't want it goes out of control? Honestly, I don't understand it so far. The point is, it's not your job in case of a reference counter to take care of the reference counter. This is the job of the C++ ecosystem, and it makes it just right. And once more, the handling of the control block, which includes the reference counter, is thread safe because under the hood, there's an atomic int which will atomically increase and decrease, so all is fine. Oh, so why do compiles don't want if there is a performance crash by using ship? Oh, this is terrible English. I cannot read it. I assume why do compilers don't want if there is a performance by using SharePoint and function arguments? Once more, this performance degradation in case of a shared pointer is extremely minimal. I made a few performance tests. I don't have the number in my head, so forget it. I made a play. I played with it. I created a function which without a body, extremely small function, and I invoked it millions of times. And I tried, this function took a shared pointer by copy and by reference. Once more, by copy, reference counter, up, down, up, down, up, down. And honestly, this was so far not easy to observe. The performance difference was not easy to observe. The point is, this operation is extremely fast. And you don't model for performance, you model for ownership. When you want to model shared ownership, use a shared pointer. When you want to model exclusive ownership, use a unique pointer. Next point, question is Ray. Also better to exactly your point. The question was about Ray. Destructor is always called in case of Ray. If when the local goes out of scope, it's at the job of the compiler to call the destructor. And this is exactly what you model with Ray. You put something which you want to take care of in a local object, you put the destruction job into the destructor, and the compiler invokes the destructor because it's a local. This is the entire trick. Okay. I think we are done with the question so far. I'm also a little bit late. I suggest I will directly go to Zoom. I will go for table one if there's place, if not for table two. And if you have additional questions, feel free to visit me. Okay, see you in Zoom. In Remo. Sorry about Zoom. See me in Remo in a few seconds. Goodbye.